Hi, Melinda.
Yes, ma'am. Good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon. So previous topics are clear, right? Any doubts on the topics?
No, ma'am. It's clear.
Okay. Okay, so size of the document, is it proper?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Fine then, so we will start. So last class we discussed some provisions regarding Supreme Court of India under Union Judiciary, Part 5 of the Constitution of India. So we discussed about how National Judicial Appointment Commission came, but then again we are still following the collegium system. So there are a few more provisions from Supreme Court of India that we will discuss today. It is Articles 124 to 147 that deals with the provisions regarding Union Judiciary. Its composition, how judges should be appointed, how they can be removed, what are their qualifications, then what will be the jurisdiction of Supreme Court, and all those details are mentioned under this provisions. So it is Union Judiciary Articles 124 to 147 of the Constitution of India. So Article 24 is like very important. It mentions regarding establishment of Supreme Court that there shall be a Supreme Court of India. Its head office would be at New Delhi. Then the judges, number of judges, etc., their qualification, that they should be a citizen of India, and then any of the other three conditions that were there. They must practice in, you know, like at least for 5 years as a judge in some high court, or for 10 years as an advocate in high court, or in the opinion of president, a person of distinguished jurist. So any of those three conditions he can fulfill, along with the first one that he should be a citizen of India. So those were the qualifications, those also mentioned under 124 only. So under 124, a lot of things are mentioned regarding number of judges and all of that. So regarding number of judges, it is mentioned that it is the, you know, like when the constitution came into force, the number was given under the provisions of constitution, but it was also said that the number can be increased, decreased according to the needs by any law made by Parliament of India. So the number is not like it's a fixed number. Whatever is mentioned in constitution, that only should be applicable, or in order to increase or decrease numbers, we need to make changes of changes in the constitution, but it can be done by the Parliament as well. So it is now the Supreme Court Number of Judges Amendment Act 2019 that mentions the current number. It is under Article 124. So we will move with the next provisions that we have.
Yes,
So Supreme Court of India is mentioned under articles 124 to 147. There are different provisions regarding appointment of judges, their salary, removal, qualification, etc. So it is article 125 that talks about salaries of judges. So there shall be paid to the judges of Supreme Court salaries as determined by Parliament. So again, Parliament is given the power to make law that would specify the salaries and any other allowances that judges may be entitled to. But until and unless Parliament makes a law, what provisions would be applicable? Whatever is specified under second schedule. So whatever salary or any other allowances are mentioned in second schedule, that would be applicable till the time Parliament makes some law in order to regulate the provisions. So what law we have now? We have Salaries and Conditions of Service Act of 1958. So you can look at the legislation also by clicking on this link. So under this particular legislation, salaries would also be fixed and any other allowances that may be provided to judges. So every judge would be entitled to such privilege or allowances or pension, etc., under the law made by Parliament. And until and unless it is fixed, it would be regulated by the provisions of second schedule of the Constitution of India. Next is appointment of acting Chief Justice. So in what all cases acting Chief Justice may be appointed and how he would be appointed? It is Article 126 that talks about appointment of acting Chief Justice. So in cases where office of Chief Justice of India is vacant, or in such cases when Chief Justice of India by reason of his absence or otherwise is not able to perform his duties. So in case Chief Justice of India is absent, is sick, or any other reason, if that position is vacant, in such cases to perform the work of his office, what happens is that an acting Chief Justice may be appointed. So duties of such office would be performed by such one or other judges of the court as the president may appoint for that purpose. So in case the position of Chief Justice of India is vacant, the what happens is that President of India can appoint any person in order to perform such functions, and we would call that person as acting Chief Justice of India for that particular time frame. So this provision again is under 126 of the Constitution, and another important article is 127 of the Constitution. What is 127? It is regarding appointment of ad hoc judges. So sometimes a question comes that which article of the Constitution of India mentions regarding appointment of ad hoc judges? It is Article 127. So who are ad hoc judges? Ad hoc judges, any idea? We read about ad hoc committees, right? Ad hoc committees and permanent committees.
Temporary judges, ma'am.
Yeah, temporary judges. So they are not like permanent judges, but for some purpose, they are appointed for a specified time frame. They would be ad hoc judges. So in Supreme Court, what happens is there is a provision to appoint ad hoc judges also. In what all cases ad hoc judges would be appointed? If at any time there should not be a quorum of judges of the Supreme Court available. So in any case, if the minimum number of judges who are required to continue with any function of the Supreme Court, if that is not there, then in such cases ad hoc judges may be appointed. So it would be, you can remember the thing that it is only when the minimum quorum of judges is not present, in such cases ad hoc judges would be appointed for such period. That is not like the person who become permanently a judge of Supreme Court, but only during that period for that specific purpose only he would be appointed. So he is ad hoc judge only for that specified purpose or that specific thing only. He would be appointed for a specified time and he would perform that function. Who can be appointed as ad hoc judge? He should be a judge of a high court duly qualified for appointment as a judge of Supreme Court to be designated by the Chief Justice of India. So he shall have the qualifications of being appointed as a judge of Supreme Court, and such person may be appointed for that specified time frame as a judge of Supreme Court. So it shall be duty of the judge who has been appointed that for that particular period for which he has been appointed, his primary function would be to perform the work of Supreme Court, whatever it is, sitting of Supreme Court or whatever it is, for the time purpose. His attendance also would be required for that purpose, and he should perform that particular work accordingly for whatever purpose he is being appointed. So these are like three important articles that you can remember. Appointing of chief salaries of judges, that it is under second schedule the provision is mentioned. Until and unless Parliament makes a law, this provision would be applicable, just how we saw in case of Union Executive also, right? That salaries and allowances of President, Vice President would be as mentioned under second schedule, but again Parliament can make changes to it by passing some laws. So same would be applicable for Union Judiciary also. Parliament can make the laws. And it is the Salaries and Conditions of Service Act 1958 that mentions regarding salaries, allowances or any other privileges that they may be entitled to. Regarding appointment of acting Chief Justice in case there is a vacancy because of any absence or any other reason during that time. Appointment of ad hoc judges would be only for some specific purpose, and that person would perform only that specific duty, and that should be his priority during that period, irrespective of any other things that he may do. So these three articles, are these clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Now, in Supreme Court, there are different benches, right? What are the different benches that we have, Supreme Court of India? Anyone? Supreme Court of India, we see, right? In cases also, it was decided by this particular bench. So, what are the different types of benches that we have under Supreme Court of India?
Constitutional bench.
Yeah. Constitutional bench and so these are the benches that we have. Single bench, divisional bench and constitutional bench. So three different benches that we have under the Constitution of India. So what are these three different benches? So what is single bench? Single bench means single judge sitting in chamber. That is, only one judge would be there who would take a decision in that particular matter. So it would be applicable for cases where the matter is, you know, like not very serious matter. It's a very simple matter for which a decision has to be taken. In such cases, it may be one single judge only sitting in chamber who would take a decision regarding it. So there may be many cases, for example, rejection of claim, then application for refund of any security that is being paid, then application for striking out of any matter in a pleading, questions arising in taxation referred by a taxing officer. So there may be many other matters. So there are around like 40 matters are there for which a single bench is entitled to take a decision regarding it. We do not need more than one person to take a decision on those matters. For example, application by third parties for a return of documents. In any case, if some documents or other things are submitted regarding return of that, a third party is making an application. So whether it should be returned at that moment only or whether they would need it for a a further time or something like that. In such cases, it would be what? It would be single bench only that can take a decision. So it would be one single judge sitting in chambers who would take a decision with regard to those matters. So you can remember like there may be rejection of claims. So the matters may be, it may be rejection of claims, Then application by third parties for return of documents. Application by third party for return of documents that may be submitted in the court for any kind of matters. So there are many matters for which a single bench can take a decision. Application for amendment of pleadings with the consent of all the appearing parties. So all those things would come under this provision only. Application for withdrawal of any appeal, petition, etc. from the Supreme Court with consent of the parties, or if another party is not present. So those matters may be decided by a single judge only. So it would be single bench. Now what is divisional bench? Divisional bench is not less than two judges nominated by Chief Justice of India. So single bench is one judge, divisional bench is not less than two judges nominated by Chief Justice of India. So any appeal that may be filed by parties or any other proceedings regarding death sentence, where death sentence has been awarded to a person by High Court, in such cases what happens is that it would be decided by a divisional bench of not less than three judges. So if there is a case that was filed in some high court and in the judgment, like death penalty was awarded to the person and the person goes to Supreme Court filing an appeal, in such cases, it would be what? It would be not less than three judges who can take a decision whether that particular judgment was valid or whether they want to revise that particular judgment. Also, if there is any urgent matter that needs to be heard immediately and there is like winter vacation or summer vacation, more judges are not available. In that case also, Chief Justice may say that this divisional bench can hear this particular matter. So it, in divisional bench, what happens is it is not less than two judges who would be nominated by Chief Justice of India. So you can remember the matter as appeal to the Supreme Court of India from a decision of High Court where a person was awarded death penalty. So in such cases also the matter would go to divisional bench. So divisional bench is not less than two judges. So you can remember that single is only one person, divisional is not less than two judges who would be nominated by Chief Justice of India to hear that particular matter. Third type of bench that we have is constitutional bench. So what is constitutional bench? It is not less than five judges. So it should be more than five. So less than five would become again divisional bench. If it is more than five, then what happens is that it is constitutional bench. Like five or more than five, it would become constitutional bench. So what is the highest number of judges who were there in one constitutional bench? In any case, highest number of judges. Highest number of judges that you can remember in any case, what was the highest number of judges who took a decision?
I think so, 7 or 9, ma'am.
It is 13 judges in Kesavananda Bharti 13. Case. So that was like the highest till date. It is 13 number of judges who were there that you can remember. It is constitutional bench, the highest number of judges who were there in Kesavananda Bharti case. So what is constitutional bench? It would be 5 or more than 5. Minimum number that we need is 5. It can be more than 5 also. So what all things would a constitutional bench decide? What all cases we need a constitutional bench? So take for example, we know that, right, that some matter may be referred by precedent to Supreme Court of India for Supreme Court's opinion, right? That if precedent thinks that for this particular matter, maybe I should take opinion of the Supreme Court because this matter is like involving some question of law or some important question and it is affecting public at large, so I should ask Supreme Court's opinion. In such matters, it would be a constitutional bench who would take a decision. it may be in any other case where what happens is that whatever is the matter of that particular case, it involves a substantial question of like interpretation of constitution. For example, a matter is referred to the Supreme Court where the parties are arguing regarding transfer of a high court judge. So they want to understand what would be the, you know, like proper interpretation of any particular provision of constitution. So the matter goes before the Supreme Court. In such cases, what happens is that it would be not less than 5 judges who can take a decision. It would be constitutional bench, and accordingly they can take a decision regarding it. So for constitutional bench, it can be any case or any matter that involves a substantial question of law regarding interpretation of constitution. That regarding any provision of the constitution, the parties are raising a question regarding proper interpretation of that particular article. In such cases, the matter should not be decided by judges less than 5. So it would be a constitutional bench who can take a decision regarding it. And also when president refers any matter to the Supreme Court to obtain its consent or to obtain its opinion. In such cases also, it should not be less than 5 number of judges. So it again would be a constitutional bench who would take a decision with regard to this. So is this part clear, constitutional bench?
Yes, ma'am.
Again, for president and vice president, if regarding their election some kind of dispute arises, who is entitled to, you know, like take a decision in such disputes? Do you remember like any dispute regarding election of president or vice president that we studied in Union Executive? If someone says that election is not valid or something like that, where would the dispute go? Who would take a decision regarding those matters? It again would be Supreme Court of India under a constitutional bench. So in case regarding election of president or vice president, under Article 71, a question goes to the Supreme Court. In such cases also, it would be a constitutional bench only who would take a decision. So here, so you can remember, it may be any case filed under Presidential and Vice Presidential Elections Act. If any matter goes to the Supreme Court, then it would be decided by a constitutional bench. Then again, it may be any case any question regarding interpretation of the constitution, any substantial question of law regarding interpretation of constitution. What is the meaning of this specific provision, or what is the meaning of this article? What right is this particular article providing? In such cases also, the matter would go to constitutional bench only, and it would be decided by not less than 5 judges. So same happened in case of that Keswananda Bharti case, whether we are having right to property as a fundamental right or not. So the matter had to be decided. So it would go to constitutional bench. For example, in any case a person is saying that I am having this particular fundamental right, so I am entitled to this type of, you know, like this kind of privileges. So if any question is there where it involves a substantial question of, you know, like interpretation of constitution, the matter should not be decided by judges less than 5. So it can, the number would vary depending on decision of Chief Justice of India, but only condition is that it should not be less than 5 judges. Also, when it can go to the to a constitutional bench, for example, there are any appeals or any other matter which is referred to the Supreme Court of India, and what happens is Chief Justice of India feels that this matter should be decided by a constitutional bench of this many number of judges. So in such cases also, Supreme Court, like Chief Justice of India, is free to constitute a bench of those many number of judges, and they would accordingly decide the matter. So we are having three different types of benches under Supreme Court of India. Single bench, there would be only one person sitting in chamber, and that particular one person only can take a decision with regard to the matter. So in case of single judge, it is like very simple matters regarding rejection of plaint, application for striking out any matter in a pleading, application for refund of security, any application made by a third party asking for return of some documents, then application for amendment in pleading. So all those matters, or withdrawal of some appeal or other things. In such matters, what happens is the matter is not very of a very serious nature. So those matters should be decided by whom? By a single bench. Only one judge would be there. In case of divisional bench, it would be not less than two judges nominated by Chief Justice of India. So it would be more than two judges, but it would be less than five judges. So accordingly, they can take a decision with regard to it. For example, one matter was filed in some high court. High court passed an order regarding death penalty of a person. The person goes to Supreme Court by way of appeal, and Supreme Court has need to take a decision with regard to that matter. So it should not be less than three judges who can take a decision with regard to it. And also regarding any matter, Chief Justice of India may decide and accordingly appoint number of judges, how many ever number of judges are needed to take a decision on that particular matter. So it would be divisional bench, not less than two judges and not more than five judges. And in case of constitutional bench, it should be not less than five judges, but it can be as many number of judges as Chief Justice of India wants. And the highest number of judges to decide any case in India is 13. It was Kesavananda Bharati case. In that case only, we had the highest number of judges who decided on the matter. But in case of constitutional bench, minimum number you should remember is minimum we need five. So in what all cases constitutional bench is needed? For example, in any matter where it involves a substantial question of law regarding interpretation of constitution. Parties are arguing regarding any provision of constitution. One party is saying that this provision means this particular thing or this particular privilege. Another party is arguing on that. So in such cases, a constitutional bench can decide the matter and properly interpret that particular provision of constitution. Then in case there are any disputes regarding election of president or vice president, under the Presidential and Vice Presidential Elections Act, in such matters also it would be the constitutional bench only who can take a decision. Number of judges would be fixed by Chief Justice of India. So like that, constitutional bench can take a decision. If there are any appeals or any other matter before the Supreme Court of India, and Chief Justice of India feels that in such cases, a constitutional bench need to take a decision with regard to this matter. In such cases also, Chief Justice of India can constitute a constitutional bench, and accordingly, the matter would be decided by by that particular bench. So is this part clear? Three different benches that we have under Supreme Court?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now what happens is that in some cases, a matter may be referred to a larger bench. Take for example, one case came before the Supreme Court of India and some divisional bench was deciding on that particular matter. For example, there were two judges or three judges or four judges, and it was a divisional bench who was hearing the matter and was dealing with the matter. But what they felt is that after a certain point of time, they felt that this particular case is involving a substantial question of law regarding interpretation of constitution. So that fact was not apparent when the case came before them. But while hearing the case, they came to know that it involves a question of interpretation of constitution. In such cases, what they can do is that divisional bench can refer the matter to Chief Justice of India, saying that this should be referred to a larger bench because it is involving some question regarding interpretation of Constitution. So in such cases, what Chief Justice can do is that he can constitute a constitutional bench of not less than 5 judges, and accordingly the matter would be referred to that particular bench. So it's not like once a matter goes to a divisional bench, they only need to take a decision. They can also say that this matter is involving a question regarding interpretation of Constitution, and so it should be referred to a constitutional bench, and accordingly it would be done. And sometimes what happens is that, for example, if it involves regarding interpretation of Constitution, that then too we know, right, that it would be by constitutional bench only who should take a decision. For example, it's a general matter, but the divisional bench is feeling that maybe we should not take a decision regarding it. It's not like interpretation of Constitution or something, it's a general matter only. But they feel that maybe we should not take a decision regarding it, and it should be referred to a larger bench. In such cases also, they can refer the matter to Chief Justice of India, and Chief Justice of India can accordingly constitute a bench. If it was like 2 judges bench, they can maybe say that maybe we need a 4 judges bench or a constitutional bench, and accordingly the decision would be taken by Chief Justice of India, and accordingly that particular bench only would take a decision regarding that particular matter. So in many cases where a divisional bench feels that this particular matter should be decided by a higher number of judges, they can request the Chief Justice of India for the same. But regarding constitution of benches, you can remember it is 3 benches, single bench, only one person can take a decision. So these are very simple matters. Divisional bench, it would be not less than 2 judges nominated by Chief Justice. So it would be what? It would depend on the matter also, and also opinion of Chief Justice. Chief Justice may consider that for this particular matter, 2 judges are only enough, but for this particular matter, maybe we need more number of judges. So accordingly, what will happen is that decision may be taken by the Supreme Court. So regarding this number of judges and all of that, what happens is that Constitution obviously cannot provide all the details, right? How it will be done, what it will have to do. So every detail it cannot do. So we have something called as Handbook on Practice and Procedure and Office Prudence, Office Procedure. So there is a handbook for Supreme Court of India also that you can refer to. It mentions all the details regarding working of the Supreme Court of India. So it also mentions regarding benches also how a case would be referred, what will happen, then also regarding jurisdiction of Supreme Court, also regarding who is an advocate, advocates on record, and all the provisions are there. If you want to refer, you can look for this handbook for Supreme Court of India. So there are handbooks for everything, right? For parliament also, we saw there were handbooks for members of parliament, so that when they join as a member of parliament, they know regarding the procedure. So same goes even for Supreme Court. This handbook in detail mentions regarding all the provisions that a person practicing in Supreme Court of India need to know. So this is the link. You can go and check for this particular handbook and see what all provisions are there. So this part, is it clear? Benches of Supreme Court?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
So you can just remember it is 3 benches, single, divisional, constitutional, and the matters you can remember that these are simple matters like rejection of plaint or application by third parties, for return of documents. Like these questions are not asked for this kind of matter, to which bench this particular matter goes. These kind of questions are not asked, but maybe like regarding single bench, what is the number of judges, divisional bench, constitutional bench, what is the number of judges, or how many benches we have under the Supreme Court of India. So the basic thing you should know, that three benches, one single bench, two or more than that divisional bench, five or more than that constitutional bench, and the highest number we have is 13 in case one in the Bharti case, and the number of judges should be decided by Chief Justice of India depending on the matter of that particular case. Okay, so we read about 125, it is regarding salaries of judges. We have one legislation that in detail mentions regarding it. This is the link in case you want to check it. Also regarding appointment of acting Chief Justice of India in case of vacancies, to perform the functions of Chief Justice of India, some acting Chief Justice may be appointed. Regarding ad hoc judges of Supreme Court, in case the minimum number of judges or quorum is not there, then in such cases, ad hoc judges may be appointed, and their main function would be to perform the task for what they are being appointed. So if it is for conducting of some sitting or some meeting or anything, that should be done by them. That should be their main priority. And that particular person should have the qualifications of becoming a Supreme Court judge, and accordingly that person will perform the task. But they are called as ad hoc judges because not like they would be permanent, only for that specific purpose only they would be appointed. For that specified period only, so they would be ad hoc judges. Okay, now next important thing that we have is regarding jurisdiction of Supreme Court of India. So what are the jurisdictions that we have of Supreme Court of India? Jurisdictions of Supreme Court, what are the different jurisdictions? Anyone? Any jurisdiction that you remember, Supreme Court of India?
So it is appellate jurisdiction and advisory.
Yeah, appellate jurisdiction. And?
Advisory review.
Yeah, advisory jurisdiction review. Which jurisdiction also we have? So basically the jurisdictions are what? Original jurisdiction, appellate jurisdiction. So these are the jurisdictions that we have of Supreme Court of India. So these are the different types of jurisdictions that we have of Supreme Court of India. So mainly we say that it is like original jurisdiction, appellate jurisdiction and advisory jurisdiction that Supreme Court has. But there are many other powers that the Supreme Court is having. For example, when we say writ jurisdiction, it is also like original jurisdiction only, right? Parties directly go to Supreme Court and file a case. So it is often like included under original only. Then appellate is considered as separate, but special leave is again included under appellate only. Then court of record is like considered as a power of Supreme Court. Then review of judgments, that also again comes under here only. So generally it is considered that Supreme Court is having three different jurisdictions: original jurisdiction, appellate jurisdiction and advisory jurisdiction. These are like the main things, but we are having many other jurisdictions of Supreme Court or many other powers also. So in case a question comes, what are the different types of jurisdictions of Supreme Court of India, you can mention these eight different categories, that it is writ jurisdiction, court of record and punished for contempt, original jurisdiction, appellate jurisdiction, special leave to appeal, review, then the precedence and also advisory jurisdiction. So you can mention it in different, like eight different headings that mention accordingly. So this is like a very common question that is often asked, that write write a note on the jurisdiction of Supreme Court of India, the different types of jurisdiction that Supreme Court of India has. So if you can, you can try to remember the articles as well, that which article is providing for what type of jurisdiction. Because these articles are important even for your MCQs. For example, a question comes under which article the President of India can ask for opinion of Supreme Court of India. So it would be Article 143, that Supreme Court has advisory jurisdiction. So if you remember the article, you can write for your subjective type question also. It would be helpful for answering your objective type questions. Then under which article it mentions that Supreme Court is a court of record, it is Article 129. So you can try to remember this, that it is Article 32, 129, 131, and then for appellate it is like 132 to 134, special leave 136, review 137, then regarding precedent it is 141, and advisory jurisdiction is 143 of the Constitution. So now what are these different types of jurisdictions that Supreme Court of India is having? So take for example, one question comes regarding jurisdiction of India. So you can write one simple introduction that Supreme Court of India is like the highest highest court for any judicial matters. It is the Union Judiciary. It is Articles 124 to 147 of Constitution that mentions regarding its powers and provisions. And then you can mention Supreme Court is having various jurisdictions or different types of powers, which may be divided in these eight categories. What are these? Writ jurisdiction, court of record, original jurisdiction, appellate, special leave, then precedent, then review, advisory jurisdiction. So we will see what are these different types of jurisdictions and what function can be performed by Supreme Court under each of these different types of jurisdictions. So first type of jurisdiction that we have is writ jurisdiction. So we have already studied this in part 3 of the Constitution, right? That writ jurisdictions are mentioned under part 3, Article 32 of the Constitution of India. What are writs? Writs are basically like orders or some directions given by the court. So court may pass an order that release this particular person because there is no valid ground for detention of this particular person. It may be some kind of directions of the court. Court may say that, issue this, perform this particular duty that you are holding. So like that, it can be by way of some orders or directions of court also. So when you explain the different types of jurisdictions, you can mention writ jurisdiction of Supreme Court is specifically applicable for Part 3 of the Constitution for enforcement of fundamental rights. And what are these? These are like right to constitutional remedy, and these are like guaranteed rights. A person can directly go to the Supreme Court of India for violation of those fundamental rights. What are writs? They are basically in form of some orders or directions of the court. Why these are important? In order to ensure that whatever rights are guaranteed to us under Part 3, we are able to enjoy those rights. So these are what? These are orders or directions. What are the different types of writs we have? Types of writs?
Habeas corpus.
Yeah.
Mandamus.
Yeah.
Certiorari.
Co warrant.
Prohibition.
Yeah.
Co-warrant.
Yeah. So what is habeas corpus? In what all cases it can be used?
Ma'am, the meaning of habeas corpus is to have the body. So yeah, it gives an order, as in the body should be present before the magistrate before 24 hours. And if due to any reason, if they are unable to do so, then proper reason should be given for the same.
Yeah. So in case of habeas corpus, it should be by way of an order. So we know that writ may be by way of order also, or it may be by way of some kind of directions given by court also. So under habeas corpus, court may give a direction that present this particular person before us And also, if they are not able to produce it, they may pass an order that give us, you know, like sufficient reasons for it, or may pass an order that you should release this particular person because maybe the grounds are not proper or something like that. So habeas corpus would be to have the body. It would be court's order to release a person or to present a person before the court. What is mandamus?
Under mandamus, the superior court, that is the Supreme Court and the High Court, gives command to the lower court.
Yeah.
Like the authority, how they can perform or how they can work.
Okay, so mandamus would be to give a command, right? Mandamus means to command. What kind of command would be given? It would be with regard to some constitutionally mandated duty. For example, one person is...
disturbance is coming, ma'am. Your voice is not coming clear, ma'am.
Okay. Now?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Now it's clear.
Background noise was there, I think. Okay, so in case of mandamus, what happens is that in case of mandamus, it is like to command. What court would command? Court would command a person to perform some mandated or constitutionally mandated duty. For example, one person is working in any particular government department. Court may order that if someone is asking for some kind of information under Right to Information Act, court may direct that you have a duty to, you know, like really disclose that particular information, so you should do it. Someone is not issuing passport from the passport office, court may give a direction that all the documents are proper, application is proper, you should issue the passport. If some RTO office is not issuing license or vehicle registration certificate, fitness certificate, court may give a direction that you should pass it. If, for example, some, you know, like Delhi Jal Board or some Bangalore Water Supply or Sewage Board is not providing proper bills for water, then in such cases, court may, you know, like pass an order. So in case of mandamus, what it would be is that it would be like a command that you should perform this particular duty because it's a constitutionally mandated duty that you are supposed to perform. So court may provide a direction accordingly and the person should do it properly. What would be prohibition? Writ of prohibition?
Ma'am, it will be kind of putting a stay order on something. Like basically this writ is issued, I think, to the lower court only so that when there is a complaint or something that they are using their power out of their limit and all. So it is a order to stop or forbid the lower court from doing something.
Yeah, and what is certiorari?
Ma'am, certiorari is also like given by the superior court to the higher court and they have the power to, I think, to quash any kind of judgment which is given by the lower court.
Yeah.
So
in case of mandamus, what happens? It may be some kind of government office, some kind of government officer who is having a duty to perform a certain task, but the person is not doing. In case of prohibition and certiorari, what happens is they are issued by some higher court to a lower court. What is the main purpose is to prevent that particular court from using, you know, like going beyond their jurisdiction or not following the rules of natural justice or things like that. In case of prohibition, what happens? It would be to prevent or stop. That means the lower court is still, you know, like hearing the matter, but it is not having jurisdiction to hear the matter. So what high court may do is that high court may ask that lower court to stop hearing the matter because they are not having jurisdiction to decide on the matter or because they are not following the principles of natural justice that hear both the sides. No one should be a judge of their own case, reason, decision. If anything has not been followed, that higher court would ask that lower court to stop right at that moment only. In case of certiorari, what happens is the decision has already been given by the lower court. So in such cases, what higher court can do is that they can certify or they can inform that this particular order or this particular judgment is quashed by them and it would no longer be valid because it was given in excess of their jurisdiction. For example, one court is having power to give, you know, like maximum of 3 years of imprisonment, but they were deciding a matter where imprisonment was like 10 years or something like that. If under any particular, you know, like particular legislation, they have specifically mentioned that this is the court that would have jurisdiction to decide on any matter. For example, Negotiable Instruments Act. Only like judicial magistrate can take a decision, first class magistrate. If some lower court is taking a decision, third class magistrate or someone like that, higher court may say that you do not have a jurisdiction on this particular matter and accordingly a decision may be taken. So in case of prohibition and certiorari, it is regarding from a higher court to a lower court. Prohibition is when the case is still pending. Certiorari is when the decision has already been taken. We will invalidate that particular decision. What is quo warranto?
Ma'am, it's asking what's your authority, as in it restrains any kind of person who is holding wrongfully holding their offices.
Yeah, so the person would be asked, what is your authority that you are holding this particular office? For example, if
public office.
Yeah, basically public office. So if a person is, for example, like acting as, for example, a judge of some court, he is not having the qualification. If a person is holding as some, for example, like under some commission or something, he is acting as a member or chairman, but he is not having the qualification, then accordingly, this writ may be issued saying that what is your authority, show us the documents or proof why you are holding this authority or why you are entitled to this position. It may even be applicable, for example, like under any commission or something, okay? For example, it specifically mentions that who can pass any kind of, you know, like notification or order, it is only the chairman of that particular commission. But some member of that commission just, you know, like issues a notification or issues an order. In such cases also, he may be asked, under what authority you have issued this particular order or notification, because you are not having the authority being a member of this particular commission. You should be the chairman, so what is your authority? So like that also it may be issued. So the first type of jurisdiction that we have of Supreme Court of India is writ jurisdiction under Article 32 of the Constitution of India. It may be by way of some kind of order or direction that Supreme Court of India would ask for like reasons or would pass some directions regarding any particular matter. So there are 5 different types of writs. You can remember that it is Article 32 regarding Part 3 is specifically mentioned. So second type of jurisdiction that we have is Court of Record and to punish for contempt. It is Article 129. So what is court of record and punish for contempt? What Supreme Court can do under this jurisdiction?
Ma'am, it is a punishable offense, I think, because it will dealt under contempt of court act, where anybody who is discreting or like who is disobeying the or misbehaving in front of the court or as per the judgment or on a judgment or decree of court or also misconduct or, you know, I think it also talks about libel and slander also. If anyone commits such things and also all such things will be offensive under code of conduct.
Yeah. So both libel, slander, both are mentioned and also civil criminal. So what is court of record? Basically, whatever judgments are given by Supreme Court, they would be like, you know, like recorded for future purpose. If any time they need to refer to those matters, even that is done for high courts also, right? The judgments are properly recorded and we can refer to those judgments at any moment. So Supreme Court of India is what? Supreme Court of India will be a court of records. The judgments given by the Supreme Court of India would be recorded for like future purposes. And it shall have all the powers of such court, including the power to punish for contempt of itself. So what Supreme Court of India can do, in order to preserve its own, you know, like integrity and other things, it can punish for contempt, including contempt of itself. So regarding contempt again, like Constitution just mentions that Supreme Court is having this particular power. But now what is contempt? What can be the, what would be the punishment? In what all cases can punishment can be given? All those details are not mentioned under the Constitution of India. So we have a separate act called the Contempt of Courts Act 1971. This is the link for that particular act. You can go through the act also if you want. So under this act, what happens is this power is given to Supreme Court and also to High Courts that they can punish for contempt, including contempt of itself. So under this act, there are two different types of contempt that it mentions. Under Section 2 Clause B, civil contempt, and Section 2 Clause C is criminal contempt. What is civil contempt? It is some willful disobedience, that willfully he is not following or abiding by any judgment, decree, direction, order, writ, or any other process of a court, or willfully he is breaching any undertaking given by a court. In such cases, what happens? It would be civil contempt. So civil contempt is basically regarding disobedience only, that the person is not following or the person is not acting according to the directions given by a court. In case of criminal contempt, what it is that it is publication of some materials. Publication may be by spoken words, by written words, by signs, visible representation, or by any other matter. It should be publication in some way of any matter which would scandalize or tend to scandalize, lowers or tends to lower the authority of the court, or it interferes with the due course of any judicial proceeding, or it interferes or tends to interfere or obstructs any administration of justice in any matter. In while a case has been decided in that time, if the person does something that would obstruct in administration of justice, if the person tries to make some, you know, like statements that might lower the like reputation of the Supreme Court or things like that. So the main difference is civil is disobedience, not following something. Criminal is publication of some matter which would, you know, like lower the authority of the court, or which would obstruct in, you know, like proper administration of justice, or in judicial proceedings, it would hamper in any kind of matter. So two different types of contempt are mentioned. For both of them, Supreme Court is given the power to punish people for contempt. Now what happens is, this definition is not like very proper, right? It just mentions that any act that would, you know, like lower the authority of court. Now we cannot define what would lower, what is not lowering, because it may be something that tends to lower the authority also. So for civil, so at least we can say that, okay, fine, person is obeying or not obeying. But for criminal, what happens is it's not very clear whether the person has actually committed contempt or not, right? Because definition is not like very, you know, like detailed definition. Anything and everything they can say that, okay, fine, this is something which is, you know, like lowering the reputation of Supreme Court of India. So the person is guilty of contempt of court. So what they do is that, obviously there are many, you know, like situations where it is said that judges are, you know, like just like that, they are punishing people for contempt. Supreme Court also, High Court also, like it is like their discretion. Whenever they feel that it is, you know, like affecting their reputation, they can just punish a person. So there are some safety measures also which are being taken in under this particular act. Like for example, any innocent publication would not be a contempt. If a case has been filed, the person proves that whatever was been published, it was an innocent publication only. Maybe he did not know that this might be offensive for the court, this might lower the court, reputation of court or something like that. The person can ask for a defense that it was like an innocent publication. He did not have any intention of, you know, like lowering the authority of Supreme Court of India. Some kind of fair and accurate report of judicial proceeding. If a case has been decided, a person, you know, like properly criticizes the matter that maybe this is not how the case should have been decided, this is how the case should have been decided or something like that. So if it's a fair and proper, you know, like a comment that is made, fair criticism that is made, or any particular proper report has been made, in such cases also person can ask for, you know, like defense that it was not like intentional or things like that. And also this act mentions regarding punishment also for criminal contempt. It's like simple imprisonment for simple imprisonment that may be given to the person, along with fine. So simple imprisonment for 6 months or with fine of, you know, like not more than 2,000 rupees, or it may be both. In case of civil contempt, it may be fine may be given. In some cases, if it is felt that fine is not enough, then he may be sent to like civil prison also, not more than for 6 months. So like that, all the provisions are mentioned under this particular legislation, what all would be the provisions for it. So whenever any judge or anyone feels that someone is guilty of contempt of court, what happens is that a notice would be given to this person mentioning that you have done these things. So we want to, you know, like institute a case for contempt of court. Accordingly, the parties would be given a chance to prove their point and, you know, like give their proper defenses and everything. And lastly, court would decide whether the matter is proper or not. Now what happens, for example, one person has, you know, like interfere, obstructs in the administration of justice. For example, there were two judges who were deciding on any particular case, and someone has obstructed in administration of justice. Now those two judges would be what? Those two judges would feel that obviously this person is, you know, like interfering in administration of justice. He is guilty of contempt of court. So the matter should not be decided by that particular judge only, because the decision might be biased. In some cases, it may be just simple act of obstruction. So it should be decided by some other judge so that a no unbiased decision can be given in that particular matter. So whenever a case has been filed for contempt of court, it should not be decided by the judge under who, you know, like during whose hearing the matter, the, you know, like incident took place. It should be decided by someone else so that an unbiased decision can be given. And why is it called that including contempt of itself? So it is not like only third parties or other individuals. It may be some persons who are, you know, like acting within their judicial capacity also. It may be some magistrate also. It may be some other person also who are acting under their judicial thing also, who may also be held guilty of contempt of court. So the second type of jurisdiction that we have is court of record, including the power to punish for contempt. And contempt is of two types, civil and criminal, and it is mentioned under Contempt of Courts Act 1971 that we have. So second jurisdiction, any doubts on it?
No, ma'am.
So first jurisdiction is writ jurisdiction, specifically applicable for enforcement of fundamental rights which are guaranteed to us. So in order to enjoy those guaranteed rights, we need some kind of, you know, like some institution that would protect those rights. So it is the Supreme Court under Article 32. Under Article 129, Supreme Court is what? It is a court of record. And it has the power to punish for contempt also, including contempt of itself. So Supreme Court, whatever decisions are given and everything, those would be recorded for future purpose. And also it has the power to punish for contempt in order to protect its integrity. And this punishment would be applicable even for contempt of itself. Even if some person within Supreme Court is also guilty of contempt, against those persons also a case may be instituted. So the matter would be decided based on the provisions of Contempt of Courts Act 1971, which is under Article 129 of the Constitution. So try to remember the article so that if a question comes regarding jurisdiction, you can just mention it is Article 129 of Constitution, and then you can elaborate on that particular point, that it's a court of record. It has all the powers, including power to punish for contempt. Contempt would be of two types, civil and criminal. So like that, you would be able to explain the different types of powers that it is having. Okay, so third type of jurisdiction is original jurisdiction under Article 131 of the Constitution of India. So what is original jurisdiction? What can Supreme Court do under this provision? Anyone? Original jurisdiction?
Ma'am, is it under, like, original jurisdiction comes under Article 32 only, and under here, the matter should come as per the writ jurisdiction? The matter can come directly to the court with the help of writ jurisdiction, if I'm not wrong.
So, writ jurisdiction also is like original only. Directly parties can go to Supreme Court, but again, writ is mentioned under a different provision 32, and original is mentioned under a different article 131. So, sometimes you would see, even on Supreme Court's website, they would mention that original jurisdiction is this and that, and also it includes writ jurisdiction. Because what is original jurisdiction? In whatever matters, we can directly go to that particular court, right? That is only what original jurisdiction is. So even for writ jurisdiction, we can directly go to Supreme Court of India. Even for public interest litigations also, cases are filed in Supreme Court of India. But you can mention it in two different categories also if you want. That writ jurisdiction is 32 only for fundamental rights. Original jurisdiction is 131, and there are three different categories mentioned. So original jurisdiction is for whatever matter. Directly case would go to the Supreme Court of India. So it is under Article 131. So it would be better if you mention it, you know, like in two different things. But obviously writ is also like directly we are going to the Supreme Court. It's also like original only, but you can mention in two different categories. So what is original jurisdiction? It is Article 131 of the Constitution of India. So original jurisdiction of Supreme Court under Article 131 of the Constitution. These are what? These are exclusion of any other court. In case of writ jurisdiction, what we know is that person can also go to the High Court also, right? Under Article 226. But in case of original jurisdiction, what happens is these are exclusive jurisdictions. Only Supreme Court is having this power. Other courts are not having the power. So that is why we can mention, you know, like in two different categories, because original is like exclusively only to Supreme Court, but writ is also like directly we are going to Supreme Court, but also we can go to High Court also. So you can write in two different things. Original,
so original will be for both High Court and Supreme Court, no ma'am?
Original is both for High Court and Supreme Court. The matters should be different. For these matters, whatever is mentioned under Article 131, High Courts or any other court should not have jurisdiction. It is only Supreme Court.
Okay.
But High Court would have original jurisdiction, but for some different matters it would have. Similarly, some lower courts would have original jurisdiction for some different matters. For example, District and Sessions Court would have original jurisdiction for some different matters. Similarly, all the other different courts. So original jurisdiction, both courts are having, but whatever matters are there inside it, that would differ.
Okay.
So in case of Supreme Court, what are the things for which it is having exclusive original jurisdiction? It is these three different things only for which it will have exclusive original jurisdiction. No other court will have power to decide on this matter. So only three things are there: Government of India plus one or more states. If there is any dispute between Government of India and on one side and any one or more states on the other side, if there is any dispute between Government of India and any state or states on one side and one or more other states on the other side, or if it's a dispute between two or more states, in such cases, what happens is the Supreme Court of India would have exclusive jurisdiction to decide on that particular matter. So it may be any question of law or fact also regarding which Supreme Court of India would take a decision. So you can just remember Government of India, one or more states, Government of India and any one or more states, and on the other side also one or more states, or it may be between two or more states also. So in all these matters, what happens is that Supreme Court of India would have original jurisdiction directly the parties would go to the Supreme Court of India and accordingly the matter would be decided. For example, the Tamil Nadu and Karnataka's dispute over Kaveri water. So that is what, that is a dispute between two or more states. So in such cases, the Supreme Court would have original jurisdiction and the matter would be decided by Supreme Court of India directly. So it's not like from some subordinate court they are coming, but directly they would go to Supreme Court of India. So this is what original jurisdiction is, only one article 131, and only three different categories are mentioned that you can remember. Take for example, if there is any dispute that under, you know, like any particular legislation or any particular law, what, take for example, for vehicles only, if they are taking a road tax, if central government is collecting road tax, then state government should not collect. If there is any kind of disputes like that between center and the state, then also such matters Supreme Court only would decide that who can collect that kind of, you know, like payment regarding using of road by any kind of vehicles or other things. So any kind of matters that falls under any of these three categories, that matter would be exclusively decided by Supreme Court of India. This is what is original jurisdiction. So original is third one, article 131. Are these three types clear? Or did content and original?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
So third jurisdiction that we have is appellate jurisdiction, articles 132, 33 and 34. Okay, appellate jurisdictions of the Supreme Court. What is article 132? It is talking about appellate jurisdiction of Supreme Court in appeals from high courts in certain cases. So in what all cases appeal would lie to Supreme Court of India from any case which is decided by a high court. So appeal would lie in the Supreme Court from any kind of judgment, decree, final order of any high court, whether it's a civil matter, criminal matter or any other kind of proceeding. When it would lie, if the high court certifies. So under article 134A, there is a provision that high court would certify that maybe this matter involves a substantial question of law and maybe an appeal can be preferred by either party. So in such cases, if High Court feels that this case involves a substantial question of law as to interpretation of constitution, then what happens is that an appeal would lie to the Supreme Court of India, but certification of High Court would be needed that they should mention it properly. And where such certificate is given, any party in that case may file an appeal. So either party can go to the Supreme Court and file an appeal. On what ground? That any such question as mentioned is wrongfully decided. So if the matter involves any substantial question of law, parties may go to the Supreme Court saying that this particular question of law is not being properly decided by the High Court. So they are filing an appeal to the Supreme Court of India. So, you know, like certification by High Court would be needed in order to approach the Supreme Court of India, and it should not be like a question of fact or it should not be any other matters like that, but it should be a question of law only, that the matter is not been properly decided or maybe it involves some things where interpretation of Supreme Court is needed. In such matters, parties can go to the Supreme Court of India. Then 133 is regarding appellate jurisdiction. Appellate jurisdiction of the Supreme Court of India. One more article is there, 133. So appellate jurisdiction of the Supreme Court of India in terms of civil matters and also in terms of criminal matters, both of that are given under two different articles. So it is 133 article and article 134 of the Constitution. So this is like a general provision that they have given, that whether it's a civil case, criminal case, or any other proceeding, whether it's a judgment, decree, final order, or whatsoever, from a high court, the matter would lie to the Supreme Court. In case high court makes a certification that it involves a substantial question of law. What is 133? It is talking about civil matters only. So in what all cases appellate jurisdiction of Supreme Court would be applicable in appeals from High Court with regard to a civil matter? When that particular matter involves a substantial question of law of general importance. For example, there is a law under which a judgment has been given but parties are not satisfied. Maybe they feel that the provisions of that particular statute are not being properly interpreted by the High Court, or that decision was not proper, they can also file a case for appeal under the Supreme Court of India, but again certification is needed. So High Court should also acknowledge that what happens is that it involves a substantial question of law under Article 134A. So you can remember this article, it is Article 134A under which High Court would certify that this particular matter involves a substantial question of law, and accordingly appeal may be preferred by either party to the Supreme Court of India. Or if the High Court feels that this matter is to be decided by Supreme Court, it may be, it is involving some, you know, like very important part regarding interpretation of any part of that particular statute, in such cases also appeal may be filed. So this is regarding civil matters, that in civil matters also we would need certification from High Court. It may involve any substantial question regarding, you know, like interpretation of any particular statute or anything. Or if the High Court feels that this matter is to be decided by the Supreme Court, in such cases appeal may be filed. 134 is regarding criminal matters. So in what all cases in criminal matters appeal can be filed? If the High Court has on appeals reversed an order of acquittal of an accused person and sentenced him to death. For example, in the lower court, what happened is that the person was acquitted, but when this case was filed as an appeal to the High Court, what High Court did is that they passed an order regarding sentence of that death penalty for that particular person. In such cases, appeal can be filed. For example, a case went to, you know, like the district and sessions court. The court acquitted the person, but when it went to High Court for appeal, High Court ordered for death penalty. In such cases, a supreme appeal may go to the Supreme Court of India. If it has withdrawn for trial for itself in any court. So Article 134 mentions regarding some powers of the Supreme Court of India, in what all cases an appeal may be preferred to the Supreme Court of India. But again, there is one provision. So 134 is mentioning certain powers, that in this particular case, an appeal may be preferred, in this particular case, an appeal would go. But what happens is, under this particular clause, it is saying that Parliament may by law confer on Supreme Court powers to entertain or hear appeals. That is, Parliament is again given power that it can extend this power of Supreme Court to hear any criminal matters in terms of appeals. So what is this? It is the Supreme Court Enlargement of Criminal Appellate Jurisdiction Act 1970 that has extended jurisdiction of the Supreme Court in terms of criminal matter. In what all cases and a case would be heard by the Supreme Court of India. So under this particular legislation, it is not like death sentence. If a person is given imprisonment of 10 years also, then also an appeal would lie in the Supreme Court. Supreme Court can hear the matter. For example, in the District and Sessions Court, the person was acquitted. In High Court, he was given a sentence of 10 years of imprisonment. Then also the matter would go to Supreme Court of India. So like that, this particular legislation has increased the appellate jurisdiction of Supreme Court in terms of criminal matters, because Parliament is giving Parliament has been given that power that it can increase that particular jurisdiction. Thank you. What is 134A? It is regarding certification from for appeal to the Supreme Court. So High Court, what they will do is that while passing or making a judgment, decree, final order or sentence, what they will do is that they will also certify that maybe in this particular case, parties, if they want, they can file file an appeal to the Supreme Court of India. So if certification is given by High Court, then parties can move to the Supreme Court for appeal under these provisions. So appellate jurisdiction is what? It is articles 132, 133, 134, and 134A is mentioning regarding certification. So what are things we need for appellate jurisdiction? Article 132 is like general thing that it is mentioning, whether it's a civil matter, whether it's a criminal matter or any other proceeding, appellate jurisdiction of Supreme Court would be applicable. When it will be applicable? If it is involving a substantial question of interpretation of constitution. 133 is regarding civil matters. If it is involving any question of interpretation of any statute or anything, High Court has also certified, then an appeal would lie. In 134, it is regarding criminal matters. If a person is given, acquitted at the district court level, but High Court gave him punishment of 10 years or more than that, then also appeal would lie in the Supreme Court of India. But High Court should make a certification under Article 134A of the Constitution of India. Is this part clear? Any doubts on appellate jurisdiction?
No, ma'am.
So three things you should remember for appellate jurisdiction. What it is that certification of High Court is needed. High Court should certify that it is involving a substantial question of law, then appeal would lie. And also there are other matters, there are legislations also that has extended the power of Supreme Court in order to hear any kind of criminal appeal. That is the Supreme Court enlargement of Criminal Appellate Jurisdiction Act 1970. So like that you can remember regarding appellate jurisdiction. Okay, so we know now that for appeal we need certification from High Court. For example, in any case, High Court is not giving us, not providing that certification, that an appeal would prefer in the, appeal can be filed in the Supreme Court of India. So what will happen in such cases? Anyone know? High Court has not certified, but this case is involving some, important matters or something like that. What will happen in such cases?
Ma'am, can the Supreme Court take over that case to the jurisdiction?
Take over the cases?
Under their jurisdiction. As in, the cases can be directly transferred from High Court to Supreme Court.
Okay, cases can be transferred. And after the case has been decided, High Court has not certified.
Will it be a judicial review or something?
It will be special leave petition. So that is the next type of jurisdiction that we are having. Okay, so special leave to appeal by the Supreme Court of India. It is Article 136 of the Constitution of India. 136 of the Constitution of India. So what is special leave to appeal? Okay. So what is special leave to appeal? For example, in any particular case, what happens is that High Court has not certified that this particular matter would go to the Supreme Court. Go to the Supreme Court of India by way of appeal. In such cases, what the parties can do is that the aggrieved party who is not satisfied with that particular, order or judgment, and certification is also refused by High Court. So what they can do is that they can go to the Supreme Court of India by way of special leave petition. So what is special leave petition? It is basically like an application that parties will file to the Supreme Court of India. So Supreme Court of India, what they will do is that they would look into the matter. In case of special leave to appeal, the parties, the aggrieved party would go to Supreme Court and he would make a, you know, like an application, and he would mention the things like basic facts and issues, and he would mention, you know, like the things, the main points why he is not satisfied and all the other things. And accordingly, what happens is that he would also mention on what grounds he wants to file an appeal and all the other things, why he is not satisfied with the judgment, why he thinks that this particular, you know, like matter is involving a question of law, how is it important for general public, all of that he would mention. Accordingly, what Supreme Court would do is that Supreme Court would look into the matter and they can decide based on the merits of the case, they can decide whether an appeal would be, you know, like they would prefer an appeal for that particular matter. They want to decide or hear that particular matter, or they do not want to hear that particular matter. So based on that, Supreme Court may, what they can do is that they may allow that particular special leave petition or they may refuse it. If they allow, then it would be like a normal appeal only. So basic thing for special leave appeal is that the High Court is not providing that certification. So the only option left for the parties is directly to go to Supreme Court and apply under special leave to appeal. If Supreme Court feels that, okay, fine, this matter is involving a substantial question of, you know, like a substantial question of law, maybe we should take a decision regarding it, then Supreme Court can take the matter and then accordingly decide. So it would be then again become like appeal only. But if Supreme Court feels that this matter is not like that important also, Supreme Court may just, you know, like refuse that particular application, and that in that case, the person will not have any particular right. So this is what the main difference is with special leave to appeal.
Ma'am?
So if, yeah.
So where would PIL lie, ma'am? Under writ jurisdiction or where it will lie, ma'am, PIL?
Yeah, so in case of PIL, what happens in case of writ jurisdiction, whoever's, you know, like right has been violated, the party directly goes. In case it is some kind of matter where, you know, like interest of maybe general public is involved, or some, a group of communities there who are not entitled to go to the, or go to the high courts, in such cases also any kind of parties can go to the court. So it may be, you know, like regarding any rights of one individual also, any fundamental rights that may be guaranteed to one person also, or it may be any kind of right that a community or the state in general enjoys also. For such cases also, it can be filed to the Supreme Court of India. Even just a, you know, like normal letter to Supreme Court of India may also be considered like public interest litigation, and accordingly decisions may be taken by the Supreme Court of India.
So, ma'am, for PIL, we don't need jurisdictions, ma'am.
Public interest litigation also you can mention under one separate category, but already there are, you know, like too many things are there.
Okay.
Yeah.
No, usually when we used to study, so under Article 32 only we used to study about little about PIL.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That's why I wanted to know whether it will come under 32 as writ jurisdiction, or it will be given as the criteria of special leave appeal and all. That's why I just.
Not special leave appeal. So under writ jurisdiction, if you want to mention, you can mention in, you know, like one or two lines that the, you know, like some other parties also can file a case for it. Even for those matters also. For example, what happened in D.K. Basu case, in Hussain Aura Khatun case also. Those cases, what happened is that those were also like some fundamental rights guaranteed to people were been violated. Those people were not able to go to the court, or maybe they were not knowing about those rights. So some socially active people just went forward and then they filed the case. Accordingly, the matter was also accepted and decided by the Supreme Court of India. So like that, you can mention that there are cases where, you know, like even some other parties, not like the aggrieved party, someone else, socially confirmed party, or maybe their relatives or someone has also filed cases. So under this only you can mention like one or two lines for this particular thing. But it won't come under special leave appeal. It will be like those aggrieved parties only. It cannot be like someone else is going to Supreme Court and filing a case.
Okay.
So special leave appeal would come under appeal only, but you can mention in separate thing, because here we need certification of High Court. If that is not given, then special leave appeal. Parties would directly go to Supreme Court saying that these are the things and this is why I feel that this matter is of public since it involves a question of law or things like that, and you should look into the matter. So accordingly, Supreme Court would decide whether they want to take the decision or they do not want to take, you know, like decision. Okay, special leave to appeal. So special leave to appeal is under Article 136 of the Constitution. Next type of jurisdiction that we have is review judgments or orders of the Supreme Court of India under Article 137. So under Article 137, it is talking about review of judgments or orders by the Supreme Court of India. So subject to provisions of any law made by Parliament or any law made under this article, the Supreme Court shall have power to review judgments pronounced or orders made by it. So there is one, you know, like rules passed, the Supreme Court rules 1966 that specifically mentions provisions regarding review jurisdiction of the Supreme Court. So if you want, you can go through this particular link also regarding review jurisdiction of the Supreme Court of India. So in case of review jurisdiction, what happens? Review is like viewing again, right? So review jurisdiction would be exercised by the same court only. That once a decision is been given, if the parties feel that maybe this decision was not proper, or if the judges feel that maybe they need to, you know, like relook into the matter, some, you know, like some evidences were not there, some points were not properly discussed or anything like that, then they would have review jurisdiction. So under review jurisdiction, the same judges, the same kind of bench of Supreme Court would take a decision regarding that particular matter. And in detail, this provision is mentioned under like these rules of the Supreme Court of India that you can go through. So this is the link for the Supreme Court rules 1966. Next is regarding precedent. So what is precedent? It is Article 141 of the Constitution. It says laws declared by Supreme Court of India to be binding on all other courts. So laws declared by the Supreme Court of India shall be binding on all the other courts within the territory of India, which is also called as precedent. That Supreme Court, whatever judgment has been provided, those would be what? Those would be binding. And they would have the power like declared law only. Whatever Supreme Court says, that would be binding on all the other courts within India, the decisions or the judgments that are given by Supreme Court of India. So when a precedent is, you know, like when a judgment is given, where a new rule is, you know, like some new provisions are mentioned by the Supreme Court of India. For example, regarding any matter, if there are no statutes, no provisions or anything, and Supreme Court says that until and unless a new act comes, or until and unless we have a legislation, this is what is to be followed. So in such cases, what happens is that those would be called as original precedent, because it has originated from the Supreme Court of India only. Before that, we were not having any other provisions regarding it. So those would be what? Those would be original precedents. It has originated from the Supreme Court of India without presence of any other laws, rules or any other thing. If, for example, Supreme Court of India accepts or again says that, okay, fine, this is what it is. That is what? Existing rules of law. Some legislation is already there, maybe some judgment has already been passed or something like that, and Supreme Court again accepts that particular judgment or again accepts that particular law. In such cases, what we will say is that those are declaratory precedent, that whatever already there, that is been declared by the Supreme Court of India one more time. So those will be declaratory precedents. So there are two different parts in a judgment, right? What are those two different parts? Obiter dictum and? So which one would be binding on the courts?
orbito dicta.
Yeah, orbito dicta would be
binding.
So the ratio decidency would be binding because that is the main reason why this decision is given. Obiter dicta means what? It is like something, some other remarks that the court has given while deciding on the matter. So those may be in terms of, you know, like making some legislations or in terms of interpreting something, but they are not like binding. Ratio decidency would have more value, but not like obiter dictum we can ignore completely, but it is ratio decidency which should have more value when we talk about Article 141. So decision would have two parts, obiter dictum and ratio decidendi. For example, if there is a case regarding school dropout. So what court has said is that court passed an order under the Child's Compulsory Education Act. What is it? They, under that particular act, they passed an order that parents or guardians should have this as an obligation. They would be liable under this particular act or something like that. That would be what? That would be the reason for that particular decision. That would be binding on all courts. But if court also makes a remark that maybe it is because increasing, unemployment or other problems that parents are not able to afford education, or parents are not able to, maintain their children or things like that because of which these problems are increasing. So those are what? Those are like remarks made by the Supreme Court or made by the judges. Those may be, having importance in terms of making new legislations, new schemes or other things, but they are not like binding. But ratio decidendi would be binding on all the other courts. So it is also called that Supreme Court of India, whatever laws or decisions are being given by Supreme Court, it would be binding on all other courts. So it's not like a jurisdiction, but it's a power that Supreme Court of India is having. So you can mention these as well, that Supreme Court's decisions or orders would be binding on all the other subordinate courts.
Okay.
So is it binding on Supreme Court itself? Whatever decision Supreme Court has given, is that binding on Supreme Court? Anyone, decisions of Supreme Court, will they be binding?
Yes, ma'am, it will be also binding on them also, and if they feel it's not correct, they can change the judgment which have given in the earlier, like they can translate into better judgment.
Okay, so for that, what condition we need? Can anyone just change the decision or what we need? So if, for example, a matter was been decided like by a two judges bench, so what we need in order to change that particular decision?
They'll have an odd number of judges.
Not like odd number of judges, it should be more than what, who decided. For example, it was decided by a bench of two judges, then it should be more than two. If it was decided by a seven judges constitutional bench, it should be more than seven judges bench. So like that they can change. So Supreme Court can make changes in the decisions in order to ensure that it is proper and it is valid. So if needed, they can change their decision, but for the lower courts it would be binding under Article 141 of the Constitution of India. So these jurisdictions, is this part clear?
Yes, ma'am.
So last jurisdiction that we have is advisory jurisdiction of the Supreme Court of India. So advisory jurisdiction, you can remember the article. It is Article 143 of the Constitution of India, under which the president can ask for opinion of the Supreme Court of India. So if there is any matter or anything where a president feels that it involves a question of law or question of fact, and maybe it would be better to take opinion of the Supreme Court because it involves public interest also, like public would be affected by that particular decision. So what they can do is that president can ask for opinion of the Supreme Court of India, and what Supreme Court would do is that Supreme Court of India what they will do is that after hearing the matter, you know, like give a report to the President of India mentioning their opinion. So is this thing binding? Like if the President asks for opinion, is it binding on Supreme Court that they will have to give this or their opinion to President? Anyone, when President asks for Supreme Court's opinion, can Supreme Court say that they do not want to provide opinion or things like that?
No, ma'am.
So see, here it is saying, right, the court may, after such hearing, if it thinks fit, provide a report. And also the President, if it involves a question of fact or expedited process, he may refer the question. So for President also, it's not like compulsory that he should refer it to the Supreme Court only. For Supreme Court also, it's not important that it should give their opinion only. For example, there is any particular, you know, like bill is pending for President's signature. President feels that it is involving a question of law or fact. It refers the matter to the Supreme Court, but Supreme Court feels that there is nothing like that. It's not involving any matter of, you know, like matter of law or fact or anything like that. It's not that important. So what Supreme Court can do is that Supreme Court may even refuse to provide their opinion. They may say that we do not want to provide, but they should give their reasons properly. They should mention why they think it's not a question of law or fact, or why is it not that important. So they should mention the reasons accordingly, and they can refuse to provide their opinions to the Supreme President of India when President is asking for. So it's not like binding on the Supreme Court, and also whatever opinion is given to the President, that is also not binding on the President. So that would definitely have some importance, but it's not like President need to follow those opinions only. So it is only like consultation only. It is advisory jurisdiction of the Supreme Court. It is only for consultation purpose. President can ask for opinion of the Supreme Court. If Supreme Court feels that it is not like involving any substantial question of law or fact or anything like that, it can refuse to provide the opinion, but it should mention clearly the reasons why it is not providing. And whenever any decision has been, opinion has been shared by the Supreme Court, it would not be binding on the President, but definitely it would have some kind of weightage in terms of, you know, like it will have persuasive value for the President also. He may take a decision accordingly, but not like it would be binding only on the President of India. So by mentioning their reasons or by mentioning their grounds, Supreme Court can even refuse to provide it. So jurisdictions, any doubts on any point?
No, ma'am.
Okay, so this is what the jurisdiction is. So there are cases also where, like for example, one bill was pending. The matter was referred to the Supreme Court of India, whether it would be proper or not, whether it would be beneficial or not, or things like that. So Supreme Court, there are cases where Supreme Court has refused to provide their opinion also when they were asked for under Article 143 of the Constitution of India. Thank you.
Okay, next we will see some questions.
So regarding Babri Masjid case also, like precedent asked for Supreme Court's opinion that there was, you know, like already temple was there, then the thing came, the dispute arose, so what is your opinion? So Supreme Court, it was referred to Supreme Court. So Supreme Court just, you know, like refused to provide their opinion, saying that it is, you know, like unnecessary, or the question is not like proper question, or, you know, like it is opposed to secularism, and they just mentioned that they are not, you know, like providing their opinion. So there are many cases where for pending bills also, for any kind of matters also, the Supreme Court has been referred and they have refused to provide their opinion. Okay, so these are the jurisdictions that we have. Writ jurisdiction, court of records to punish for contempt of court, original jurisdiction, appellate jurisdiction, special leave to appeal, review of judgment or order by the Supreme Court, law declared by Supreme Court to be binding on all courts in India, advisory jurisdiction of the Supreme Court of India. Also, there are cases where, you know, like transfer of certain cases. So it is under Article 139A of the Constitution of India, where Supreme Court can ask that these matters are to be transferred to the Supreme Court of India. This happened in S.P. Gupta case that we saw in last class, right, regarding judges transfer. So what happened were that many cases were pending in different high courts regarding transfer of high court judges, appointment of high court judges. So what Supreme Court felt is that all these matters are, you know, like dealing with the same type of question, and also it includes, you know, like some kind of important question of, you know, like law or fact. So what Supreme Court did is that it asked that the matter is to be referred to the Supreme Court of India, and then accordingly it took the decision. So you can mention the transfer of, you know, like matters also under this if you want, under Article 139A of the Constitution of India. Or here also you can mention like review of judgments and also transfer of the matters that they can ask for. So this part, you can write, this is like very important part. I have seen many questions being asked. So if any question comes, you can mention in, you know, like these different headings that under this jurisdiction, these things happened, under contempt of court, this happens and things like that. So benches of Supreme Court, is this part clear?
Yes, ma'am.
So there are three different benches, single bench, divisional bench and constitutional bench. Single benches, only one single judge would be there. He would take a decision. Matters are like very simple matters like rejection of claims, application by third parties for return of any documents. In case of divisional, it would be more than two, but it would be less than five judges as nominated by Chief Justice of India. In case of constitutional bench, it would be five or more than five, and the matters would be decided accordingly. The highest number of judges was 13 judges constitutional bench in case of case 1 under Bharti case. And what all matters should come under this regarding any dispute of presidential or vice presidential election, or any cases involving matter of interpretation of Constitution of India, like the case 1 under Bharti case, whether right to acquire property is a fundamental right or not, or any
ma'am,
other
what
provision
was the number,
of what?
What was the number of judges?
13 judges bench. That was like the highest number till date. Okay. So these are some questions we'll try to solve. First one, what would be the answer?
Original jurisdiction.
Power of the Supreme Court of India to decide dispute between center and state would fall under original jurisdiction.
Is it 143?
Yes, it is. Article 143 that opinion of Supreme Court can be asked for. Third one.
Ma'am, is it 3 when requisite number of judges are not available?
Yeah, when requisite number of not available to hold any meeting of the court. So ad hoc judges would mean for that particular meeting or for that particular purpose only, they would be appointed, and it is under Article 127 only when quorum, minimum quorum of the number of judges is not present. In such cases, ad hoc judges may be appointed for that particular purpose. The law stated by Supreme Court of India becomes law of land under article, it's like that precedent thing only, that whatever is held by Supreme Court of India, that would be followed by everyone and things like that. Which article? Which article is it? Law declared by Supreme Court of India to be binding on all the other courts. That means it becomes like law only. Whatever is declared by Supreme Court in a judgment, it will be applicable on all the other courts. So it will be under Article 141 of the Constitution of India. Next one. Five number of judges that we need. So minimum is 5, maximum the Chief Justice would decide based on the matter.
162 years.
60, what years?
65
years, option number 2. Question number 7.
Ma'am, is it A?
When principles of natural justice are not then followed.
Achha, are followed, okay, and I think it's more.
When President and Prime Minister are not satisfied or has committed misconduct of the same, has been proved for incompetent.
So it is under Article 124, it is C option, third one, that when an address is passed by both the Houses of Parliament and also the, you know, like proven misbehavior is established or incapacity is established. So it is 124, under Article 124, the third option.
Mm-hmm.
Both B and C?
Yeah, both B and C. So see, only dispute between state and individual, that would be like writ jurisdiction only, right? So writ is not covered under original, so we will select B and C. Both B and C would be original jurisdiction.
Ma'am, but it also says the dispute between state and the government also.
Dispute between?
State and the government. Usually it is state and the government. But here the option is not there, state and the government.
Only for violation of fundamental rights, only for dispute between two states. Only dispute
between... exclusively extend to dispute between the government of India and more states and between government of India and other states. So it will be between states and government.
Yeah, so we can select this because the only cases of violation of fundamental rights. If it is violation of fundamental rights, it would be under writ jurisdiction. So
written original. It is only.
Yeah, so only this only we can select. So only in cases of violation of fundamental. Sorry, only in cases of dispute between two states, it would be original jurisdiction. If it is violation of fundamental rights, it would be writ. Again, writ and original are like different only, right? Because original is like exclusively for Supreme Court it is available. So third one only would be the better option to select. Because these two would be like writ only. State and the citizen and also fundamental. Question number 9.
Only the fundamental rights.
Only the fundamental rights. So see, original jurisdiction is, you know, like often combined with writ jurisdiction. But when you are writing, try to write it, you know, like separately. Because, but in question, many times you would see that writ is also included under original jurisdiction only. So if it is like very clear under Article 32 and all they have mentioned, then you can select. Otherwise, just select this only because original is different thing and it would be only for those exclusive three things only. So for this, because they have mentioned under Article 32, you can select that fundamental rights.
Next one, 10.
Ma'am, President. Achha, it's High Court.
President of India.
Ma'am, I think President.
So this question by mistake I have added. Fine. Next one.
It's 2 o'clock.
It is original appellate and advisory. All the three types of jurisdictions. The original jurisdiction of treaty making is conferred upon.
President.
Yeah, it is President of India. President of India under Article 73. President of India. So union part is over. Any doubts on any part? Supreme Court of India?
No, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
And if we get some more questions, we will try to solve that. And next class, we will start with the states part 6 of the Constitution of India, okay? And then I'm ending today's meeting, okay? Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.